question was, unless you were the original investor, where you were going with that, where you thought it would go, as far as secondary market investor. I mean,
I wasn't going too far because there's really nowhere to go yet. What we're going to see is, once it goes live, we're going to start to see how active the secondary market is. There's going to be secondary market. It's really going to depend on, how well the company's doing. Obviously, if the company started, they've been in business for 12 months, their shares would be able to be sold, but they're not very successful. The chance of being able to sell it.
So all of these questions are what is trying to make a private placement for the public market, whether or not, what are the post-financing communications, what's the after-market trading. And I start with, a private placement today requires nothing. No information to the credit investors unless it's anti-corrosion. And there's no post-financing communications that are required unless the agreement requires. And even when that happens, it's done exceptionally poorly by most entrepreneurs after the fund. What's going to happen in this world, as Zach is saying, if things go according to plan and it's done through a funding platform, isn't required in Title II, it is required in Title III. If better platforms will require ongoing information, as Kim is saying, on a monthly basis, it may be a Google Hangout where the entrepreneur has to account for what they've been doing, information, emails, and as it relates to the secondary trading, you cannot do secondary trading in any security in this country unless you are an exchange or what's called an alternative trading system. So these funding platforms are not licensed to do that unless they become a broker dealer and have permission to do that, assuming market appetite, and then how do you transfer shares with the permission under the law? It's not as simple as it's a registered security on an exchange.
Yeah, definitely. I'm very curious. There are a lot of good news coming from the African transfer that we have probably 5-6 years from now. We are 50 million Africans making their way into the middle class. That's a big pool of capital. And then so many projects go unfunded because of lack of capital. And then at the same time, the accounting standards are not well structured. And then the financial market are almost non-existent on the African continent. So do we see any experiment of crowdfunding making its way maybe from the USA into the African continent or from Europe into the African continent? If you see any, can you share some of these insights into crowdfunding Africa as the next frontier market on the planet?
What we're seeing in the entire developing world is that we're really seeing the potential for crowdfunding in the developing countries. I think what we're going to see is it's going to have a huge impact here in the United States, but where we're going to see even a larger impact is in developing countries like in the African continent. We're going to see a lot of that diaspora, people who are investing back in their countries from back home, people who have left their country, who have made money, and who are now wanting to help support. And so right now, there's really no mechanism for that to happen. Crowdfunding is going to be the mechanism for this money to be invested back at home so businesses can start growing.
The day-to-day nitty-gritty, and just by example, let's say I'm a small entrepreneur and I associate with a platform and they put something out there and suddenly 1,000 investors come in. Does the platform handle the vetting and the minutia of the statements and who's accredited, who's not accredited? Does that fall on the entrepreneur's class and suddenly they're burying paperwork until Christmas?
So under Title III, the way that the
I can't hear you well.
Under Title III, the way that the rules have been drafted, the issuer is actually responsible to ensure that the investor has certifies they understand what they're investing. of investing and losing all their money in that particular offering, and basically checking the box that they can actually risk losing all of their money. That does fall on the heads of the issuer. However, the platforms, recognizing that the issuers are not able to support that sort of infrastructure, they've built this into their platforms. And so the funding portals have actually taken the responsibility, though they're not mandated to, they've taken on that responsibility to help the issuer to make sure that they are only investing with people who understand the risk of making this sort of placement.
But what about finding out if they're accredited or not?
For Title III, you can be an accredited and a non-accredited investor. And so you don't have to verify that you're a non-accredited investor. You really have to verify that you are an accredited investor. And so under Title II, there is a mandate now where you actually have to do verification, whether it be through your accountant, through an attorney, through disclosing some of your own financial information, that you are an accredited investor. And so today, I think Doug mentioned earlier, it has been tick the box, certified that I'm an accredited investor. Unless you placed money previously with a particular money manager, you will now have to do self-certification, but then it has to also be verified through a third party.
Who's the third? That's what I'm asking. They don't have the answer to
it. So the third party can either be your accountant, an attorney, a broker dealer. You could submit your own financial information.
There's services already created that are going to be focusing on that market. So one second market is the 500-pound gorilla. They announced the day after that came out that they're launching an accreditation service. They sort of want to be a clearinghouse or be one service where opposed to an investor having to go to 50 platforms and re-certify each time, just going to second market or just going to a computer service. Some platforms are probably going to bake that in as well. They're going to offer that service.
So like PayPal will be investor pal.
Yes.
You'll register and you'll be accredited and we'll get your number and they'll be gone.
It's possible that it's possible we're headed there, but because the industry is new in this respect, as Johnny just stated, second market is probably the only company to date that probably is coming to the market with something as elaborate or big vision for day one exercise.
Guys, if I could just ask the panel one final question, because I want them to go down the row and speak about the opportunities. And then we can open it up for all these great questions, because there are some really great questions, and I don't want to keep pausing to come back to the panel. I'd like to just open that up at the end. So if each of the panels can share, in 30 seconds or less, what opportunities they think are going to be created because of the whole crowdfunding industry, and where they see this going in the next 5 years.
I think there's going to be endless opportunities in this industry that we're going to see. It's going to be in the obvious areas where the entrepreneurs who want to raise capital, the portals who are going to be making money through enabling these money raises, and then also from the investors. Those are the obvious ways, the three people who are being connected. But then the add-on and the follow-up services are going to be endless. So like Jonathan was just saying about the third-party accreditation, making sure that people are accredited. That's a third-party service, accounting services, and all the other services that are going to be surrounding this industry. It's going to be huge. We're going to see. Fred Wilson of Union Square Ventures is estimating $300 billion a year is going to be funneled through this industry. So $300 billion a year is funneling through. Imagine the amount of money that's going to be made for follow-up services.
So, yeah, I think this is, we're re-regulating the markets, and we are really deregulating how business is done today. So, we all think through how, companies like Facebook or LinkedIn, how they've raised money, and now they have multiples of, 15, 20, 30, whatever that is in terms of, the exit strategy. Where I think that's going to still happen, but where I see this becoming an enormous enormous value and benefits to local communities. So most often when you live in an urban society, you actually go to the bank to take out a personal loan or a business loan to get your business up or to keep your business going. And so with crowdfunding, it allows you to tap into your community. It allows the community, which some communities are sort of generational, it allows them to keep putting money back into the environment in which they live and they breed and they will want to see it prosper. So I see that being probably for me the most interesting opportunity with this, because we don't think about small business anymore, though that's where, you know, the United States is actually founded upon principles of small business. So I think we're going to see a lot of that come back to what Zach was saying about third-party opportunities. I myself am creating a third-party business around ratings. So when you think of Morningstar, we're creating the ratings agency as well as research and analytics for this environment. So when you start thinking about fraudulent activity, or you start thinking about what do you know about a company, we want to be able to come to the market and show you and tell you about the companies that you are investing in. So whether you're getting that annual statement or that quarterly statement, we'll be putting out information and allowing the crowd to come in and share their perspectives on whether or not a company is actually viable and should we continue to fund it. So lots of opportunity, and it's an exciting time.
I think all the efforts of the people up here and a lot of people in the broader crowdfunding community will demonstrate that the way we do things in the public markets isn't necessarily as perfect as everybody believes. And there will be people who do things differently. The way Kim is doing the electronic dashboard I referred to with monitoring use of proceeds, I think there will be a lot of technology advancements that will make transparency more efficient. But I think the real exciting part, what Kim was referring to, is I think people who have not had access to capital in this country, who are just as talented as people, who go to the best institutions and Helder White law firms and investment bankers, who have access to capital, and they are going to do things, whether it's in the United States or in Africa or elsewhere, they're going to have access to money in ways that we've never enabled them to do things and empower them. And I think the establishment will be well aware that it's going to be a new establishment over the next 25 years. That's not my call to arms. I think it's all going to work very nicely together.
Yeah. So I have four siblings, and I'm definitely the black sheep. Everyone that comes to medical, dad's a doctor, mom a nurse practitioner, brother a nurse, sister a nurse. And they are all completely detached from their investments. They don't have a financial services background. They don't trust them. I see that everywhere. You know, public markets are devoid of trust. There's a study put out by Chicago Food that shows fewer than one in five Americans trust the public markets. Fewer than one in five. If that's any other marketplace, it fails tomorrow. That's a growing marketplace. If fewer than one in five people trusted eBay, it would fail tomorrow. But why do our public markets not fail, or why do they not evolve, and why do they not change? And they don't change because there's no alternative. Now, where else can we put our money? There is nowhere else. Our checking account gives us nothing. There is no alternative asset. Crowdfunding, security crowdfunding, online funding, it opens up private markets. It gives us that alternative. The $300 billion stat, that's 1%, so that's $30 trillion. And we all hear this statistic often, but it's head on. $30 trillion of invested assets in the US. 1% of that is $30 billion. So even 1% of that goes to the private markets. It's an enormous volume. So I think the opportunity to actually invest in businesses that finally that we trust, that we know, that we're not investing in a market with 60% algorithm that we traded, where we all know the deck is stacked against the retail investor. And we don't figure this out. We have a moral imperative to figure this out. Because we don't create access to the private markets, in 10, 20 years, retail investors are going to open up their portfolio and realize that their returns did not track the economy. Because all the value creation is taking place in the private markets. Companies are waiting to go public longer and longer. Facebook went public at $100 billion. For retail investors to get a 10x return, it would have to be a $1 trillion company. That's absurd. Retail investors are never going to see that. Yet, if they invested in the technology companies and our fastest growing companies and our innovation economy in the 70s and 80s, the HPs, Compaqs, Apples, Microsofts, they had a chance, they had a shot. Now they have none. We've seen the advent of the $100 million Series B round. The private markets are taking over. If we don't create access to them, all the value excited about, is I can, for the first time, actually open my portfolio and see investments that I care about, which I'm pretty excited for.
Awesome, thank you guys. So let's open it up to you guys. Please answer or ask any questions and we'll be happy to answer them.
Florida, we're working with a company that has done more online sales And I'm not talking about the interesting new tech app companies. I'm talking about real restaurants and things like that. And they are going to make their data feed available to investors so they can see what recent transactions have been priced at. And that's the way we hope valuation will be tackled maybe more intelligently than in private conversations.
You mentioned something where the platforms can only focus on themselves to the platform themselves, but inside the platforms, is there anything you can do within the walls against them having recommendation engines, like on Netflix or anything else? So it was all the algorithms of the recommendation engines based on what the investor is really looking for in order to develop it and suggest to them solutions.
So today, again, in the statutory rules, funding portals cannot curate the deals, they cannot rank the deals, they can just allow you to list on their platform. So it is illegal for a funding portal, technically, to push one deal up higher on the chart than another. You can't do the algorithms that you're talking about.
So they can't have a customized recommendation just for that?
No, they cannot. They're not supposed to.
Well, let me just add, it could be because what Kim's referring to is that that would be deemed to be giving investment advice. However, the platform can ask you if you want to opt into being profiled in that way. I like biotech deals. Please push more biotech deals or med device deals to me. But the platform cannot proactively.
So it has to be neutral, but you can opt into or intelligence.
Hey guys, those rules are still being hashed out, as Kim's saying. There's been some change in position by the staff over the last year, and Tom Patel has come down, but that's been the historic analysis.
And I was just notified that we're approaching our advertised 11 o'clock ending, so I think we'll take one more question, and then the panelists will stay up here. If anyone wants to come up afterwards and ask any questions, we'd be happy to do that.
Yes,
sir.
Going back, what advice would you have in very early stage companies that are the
companies that aren't going to be selling equity or debt, and how do they make the compelling pitch. So the most important part of your funding raise is the first few days. People want to see traction. So before you put your pitch live on one of these sites, Kickstarter, Indiegogo, RocketHub, you want to find your close connections, people who can commit to invest in you. Let them know when you're going to be going live, make sure that they know about it, and on those first few days, get them to invest in you. You want to reach out to all your friends and family on your social media. You want to make a very compelling video talking about what you're doing, how you're going to use the money, why you're in the business, why you're passionate about it. Really make the appeal to your network.
All right, great. Thank you guys so much. Please give a big round of applause. Okay, we're at a university. We just heard the lecture, now it's time to take the test. I don't know about you, I thought this was tremendous. I learned a whole lot, and certainly this is such a fascinating area, and to know that it's all going to break wide open here in the next little bit of time. So, again, thank you for each and every one of you for coming out. Thank you for your questions and making this so engaging. But what I really want to say is a special thank you to these five people. Zach drove down from Albany last night. I know the folks from New York City got up super early this morning and are over here. So it's just their generosity to share what they know and their experiences with all of us and to inure in some way to the benefit of our Feliciano Center for Entrepreneurship at Montclair State University. So I'm so appreciative of what you did and your being here today. Thank you so much. If you would like further kind of high-quality programs like this, become friends with Meetup at startup.montclair.edu, which is the Feliciano Center website. We have lots of things coming up. We have Seth Goldman, the creator of Honest Tea, in a couple of weeks. We have a meetup in a little bit of time, and Matt Bars from IntelliQuid is going to be presenting there, along with Jeff Leventhal of Work Markets. So watch us, follow us, and I appreciate your being here. Thanks very much, and have a great Friday evening.